Today for In Conversation, I'm very lucky to be in Kristiina Sandoe's lovely woodland garden near Mepham, where she's going to talk to us about collagraph and jelly printing. So I'm here with Kristiina Sandoe, who's one of our tutors at Medway Fine Printmakers. She takes the collagraph classes, and she's also a regular user of the studio, kind of using our etching press, and very much one of our favourite artists. We had her doing a one-person exhibition solo show last year, which was very, very well received and appreciated. And she's agreed to talk to us about her methods and collagraph and jelly printing.
In terms of my art, I would say that I'm very much, or have become, very landscape based. My initial ideas about landscape started with a concern less for what the landscape looks like and more for what the landscape feels like. And I think actually having just said that, that may be one of the things which has led me into a kind of a textural exploration.
Yeah, texture's become a huge thing in your work, so exploring landscape through creating textures out of next to nothing, really, kind of bits of rubbish.
In terms of the reusing things, there's something hugely satisfying about taking rubbish and kind of celebrating things which are neglected, things which are generally discarded and unimportant. I think this may partly come from my age, from having sort of grown up with an approach to things that everything needs to be reused and recycled. I think it may also be partly because of working in archaeology, where basically you spend an awful lot of time drawing dead people's rubbish, really, which is what the process is about. But yes, the idea of taking something which is essentially rubbish and then trying to create something beautiful or important or worthwhile, yeah, it feels good.
So the first time I saw you doing jelly printing, you were within about 5 minutes taking bits of paper and tearing it and making mountains and perspective, and I knew you were going to get a really good command of it very quickly. And the working with textures thing, just it comes out brilliantly in jelly.
So I started by doing your course, didn't I? I hadn't actually seen it really before that. And you're right, I took to it absolutely straight away, because again, although it's a planar graphic sort of process, it shares a lot in common with collagraph in that we can use any old rubbish to create images, and you are less in control. And this is something I really like, you know, that the random tearing for me of paper or crushing of paper or whatever creates more interesting marks than if you actually take control by trying to cut or shape things or using readily identifiable things. So for instance, I will use leaves and string and all that kind of thing as well, the same as lots of people do. But what I particularly like is things which then become unidentifiable or sort of difficult to discern where they've come from. I think as well the layering of the colour by using quite a lot of the medium to actually sort of create quite sort of semi-transparent colours.
The printing medium, so an additive you add into the paint.
Yeah, that's right. Using varying degrees of that can then create, instead of dense colours, you can actually get this this overlaying of sort of transparent colours, which does share quite a lot of qualities with watercolour. And again, I think that lends itself to creating light space. So I seem to have fallen into using the jelly plate process for creating light and bright atmosphere, whereas the collagraph, I think I tend to use for more sort of dark and brooding sort of atmospheres. I don't know why I'm drawn to such dark places. One place which I really enjoyed was a few years ago, there were some bitumen tanks on Gravesend Riverside, and the nice people who were working on them actually allowed me to go and do some drawing there, and even drawing on the inside of them. And the inside of the bitumen tanks is just this huge dark space, and it's just full of like rust and echoes basically. And I think they were a little bit perplexed about me getting very excited about a load of rust and rusty metal. But they humoured me.
So you just went and asked them?
They saw me drawing, and the chap said that thing where they go, "Can I help you?" Meaning, what on earth do you think you're doing? And once I explained that I wasn't doing anything untoward, they just let me come on. I said, "I'm an artist, I'm interested in your site." And so it was Conway's. They were running the site, and they let me spend the summer going and doing some drawing there. Always made sure that there was somebody to make sure I didn't get myself run over. So I did a whole nice project out of that. Apart from that, in caves, things like that. I seem to find myself in caves quite a lot. And just generally drawing in the dark. And I don't know what's so interesting about it, except on reflection, I think maybe again, it is this theme of relinquishing control, because you can't see what you're doing and you can't see what you're getting, so you've just got to wait and see. And sometimes it's interesting and sometimes it's rubbish, but somehow it becomes something else, doesn't it? And I think that's what I like about it.
There was a series of fireflies images you did from New Zealand as well, wasn't there?
Yeah, I've forgotten those, yeah. And again, that was quite magical, because you had to just wait. And everyone was just waiting, because there was quite a few people had gone there to have a look at them. And you just start off with one or two, and everybody's sort of oohs and ahs over the one or two. And of course, as the light gets darker and darker, then they become clear and there's more and more of them. So that was, I'd forgotten that. That was like really quite a magical experience. It's been a long time since I've seen fireflies or glowworms. Don't know what the difference is.
I don't
actually. I have seen fireflies here in this garden, but not for some years. But there was something magical about that. And there was something nice about drawing in the pitch dark, because I couldn't see a thing. And so the drawing I started off with was just a kind of almost like sort of random scrawl and memory as well, just infilling with memory. And again, I find that quite liberating.
There's something quite risky in the jelly printing approach, I think, because you can't really repeat them unless you kind of like kept really meticulous kind of step-by-step kind of record of what you did each stage. You have to just do it and then it's done and it's gone kind of thing. You've got the print and then you can't really repeat it. And then Collagraph as a process has got, it takes forever to ink up those large plates that you do. And you can repeat it, but not quite the same. You couldn't really do a very big edition of kind of like a coloured print, I imagine. But I think the processes have got, although they've got a lot of similarities in their use of texture and materials, they feel quite different in the actual doing.
Yeah, I think with the Collagraph plates, you're right, you can do sort of massive additions. I rarely do. Eight is about the absolute maximum. And of course, because it also depends on the nature of what you've used there, some of the materials I use just deteriorate, they just disintegrate almost straight away, so you might get three or something. But yeah, every time you're inking up, it's always going to look completely different. And I kind of like that, because you can have a set of things which are, they've generated from the same plate, but they have sort of somewhat different atmospheres. So yeah, I mean, it's just exploring and exploiting the qualities that each medium has, really. So that initial response to landscape has been something about exploring the way it feels. And I think that was generated from an idea of, rather than looking at landscape, of actually travelling through it and actually feeling a direct contact with the landscape. So texture then obviously comes to the forefront there, where you're thinking about how, for instance, the rocks feel under your feet or under your hands if you're climbing, that kind of thing. Because so much is about mapping as well, so it's about recording and mapping as I go along. So it's just sort of picking up the sort of the qualities of things along the way. Another thing which can sort of help is sometimes I'll sort of like pick up random objects along the way and almost take rubbings from them, or actually sort of like creating little palettes of the colours that you can get from things, you know, burnt wood or sap from leaves or grass or something. And that all kind of contributes and feeds back into it. It's all about exploring really the sort of materiality, I suppose, of the landscape that's around me, rather than its kind of like initial look.
Yeah, the sense of a place.
Yes. Yes, it's really trying to get to the core, like the essence of the place, much more so than just recording it the way it looks. So yeah, the way it feels in transition, like with the light changing or as you're moving, you've got that whole motion parallax thing going on with everything. It's just constantly changing its relativity, and like how do you record that, and how do you record the kind of the temporal nature of a journey. Okay, so talking about these dark places, here's a couple of examples, and I've brought the collagraph plates to show you. Here I've got a couple of examples of the collagraphs I did from the bitumen tanks. So these are the interior of these huge metal round spaces. This is actually looking up at the ceiling, and what I've tried to do is use materials which are either found on the site or which in some ways relate to the subject matter. So this here is part of some plastic fencing material which I managed to salvage from the site, and I quite like that because it kind of echoes the structure of the ceiling, which had sort of what you call those things, like raft, almost like rafters but metal, you know, that kind of thing. This is an old sanding disc. So again, although it wasn't from the site, it kind of relates to this idea of building. This one is a little bit more structured, so I wanted to get a sense of the perspective. The whole of the floor was just running with these rusty pipes. So I've tried to actually cut into them. So there I'm actually taking a bit of control, but then also trying to marry that with various very worn pieces of sandpaper. So again, top rolling to get the contrasty light colours. So that just sort of like brings a little bit of a zing of colour into what would otherwise be really, really dark. Here's one of the larger ones of landscape. This is actually in New Zealand. I do like working on a big scale, even though obviously with the inking up that can cause its own problems, but I think it's kind of worth it. One of the things I like about collagraph is the way you can break out of the rectangle, and for me this is quite important because you can give a sense of the landscape extending. I tend to use this and also sort of like using separate plates which then actually sort of go together. Just created very simply by using crushed and torn paper, and also you can cut into it, you can get a little bit more precision in some of the shapes and a little bit more delicacy in the lines where you're really kind of like drawing with a blade or drawing with a needle. This is quite a good example of using the very, very random textures with torn paper and then some precision drawing with a needle. So see here, sort of hidden amongst this lot, you've got a wheelbarrow. So this is a site, it's actually the site of the walkie-talkie building. When they were digging the site, doing the archaeological investigation, because I used to work in archaeology, and they very kindly said I could come and do some drawing on this site. So there's a whole series of work from archaeological sites as well. Again here I've actually done sort of like a little bit of spot colour as well as the hard rolling. So here are some of the jelly prints. You can see, I'm hoping they'll show a range of mark making. Typically, this has got some torn paper. You can actually see these torn edges, and they've been overlaid to create a sort of like a depth of tone. All fairly random. I mean, it's not sort of like overly planned. Here you can see to get, because there's more structure in these, this is actually North Fleet Harbour. And I've used just like the sides of some plastic crating to create these sort of zigzag structures. Again, just torn paper creating this sort of like, you know, layers of dark and light. So one of the hardest projects that I've worked on, which just came about when my husband became terminally ill, was a series of sketches that I did on hospital visits. So I couldn't bear to take photographs of him because he was so unwell, but I could manage to do drawings of him and also the environment that suddenly became our new world. I think it showed me how very much your initial responses to something, sometimes out of boredom or frustration or whatever it is, can be reflected in the finished work without you actually intending to put it in. So rather than trying to convey those feelings, you find that they actually sort of come out almost like they're there all the time. So for instance, the very last drawing I did when he was in hospital was when I went to lay down in the car when my sister-in-law said, go and see if you can get some sleep, and I knew I wouldn't sleep. So I put the seat back in the car and stared out at, I think it was the ambulance station or something, and couldn't sleep, so I did a sketch instead. And I did it from the angle that I was lying, so the whole thing was wonky. And that was only coincidental because that was my viewpoint. When I looked at it afterwards, I realised that it just showed the whole world rocking, and that was exactly how I felt.
So Kristiina, thank you so much for joining us today and tell us about your work. It's been great, and I can't wait till you're back at Medway Fine Printmakers on our etching press.
You're very welcome, Kristiina.